what's the most unrealistic expectation you had about parenthood before having your kid?
That he would sleep. You know, I think sleep is something which is so basic.
So have you ever googled about being a good mom or to handle some?
Yeah. And in the book I've written, please don't google. You know? Because I know we all google, right?
So what's your suggestion to young mom who have conceived recently? If you are planning a baby or if you have recently had a baby, go with this Sleep, Support and Sanity. It's a beautiful book, available over Amazon and all the major bookstores and everywhere. It's a complete guide for you. Hello guys, and welcome to a show of Books and Theories podcast. I've recently read a book called Sleep, Support and Sanity, written by Rashima. Bahut hi interesting book hai. I'll say mere liye bahut interesting thi because I'm having a daughter 3 years old and I've been into that phase ki kaise baby hota hai and how everything works. So this book gave me a good insight, and today we have Rashmira here on our show where we'll be discussing a lot to her. So welcome Rashmira to our show. I hope I'm pronouncing your name correct.
Yeah, Rashima. It's Rashima, yeah. Thank you, Himanshu.
So I'm coming directly on the question, but my question is a little different. I've stalked you a lot over Facebook before going and preparing these questions. So you are a celebrity author now. Last year you...
If you say so. I'll say.
Because last year you won PVLF. Right? And you're an entrepreneur. But I'll ask you to go back somewhere around, say, 25, 30 years.
You want me to go back into the past?
Yes.
Okay.
And then tell us, who is Rashima? Who was Rashima?
Okay. So many years back, she was a student. And she was studying in school.
Where?
And I was in Bluebells International.
Delhi.
East of Kailash. Okay. Yeah. Delhi. And yes, but I will say, ever since I was 7 years old, I wanted to be a writer. Uh-huh. So I was only seven when this dream of, you know, being an author actually germinated. It happened when I wrote a short story for an inter-school competition and I won. And I think something to do with the culture in my school, because it was a very futuristic school. And at a time when, you know, schools were essentially focused on academics, our school was constantly driving us to follow our passion. Mm. So that's how it all started. I then went on to write, you know, short stories and poetry for newspapers, magazines, got them published, tasted a bit of success there, and that's how this whole thing started.
And this entrepreneurship?
Yes, so I did my MBA. So after my college, after my graduation, I went to the UK, University of Durham. I did a management course, then I came back, I did another MBA, and I joined the family business, which was strategic consulting and business research. And I have been in the corporate sector since then. So that's, you could say, the other side to me. That's what I do for a living. Writing is what I do for a passion.
It's same with me. Like I'm actually an automation. I'm an engineer actually.
Right.
But yes, writing is my passion. And these lights, camera, this is also my passion.
Yeah.
Like you have started writing since 7. Same with me. So I still remember when I was 5 or 6, I was too much fascinated about those novels. Ved Prakash Shukla and all those novels used to come. So my elder brother, he used to read those things. Because we were in a joint family.
Okay.
So I frequently see him reading those thick novels of Ved Prakash and all those things. So I was too fascinated looking at those covers and everything. So what I used to do, I take hardboards and I stick them with a fevicol with few papers inside, and I'll just scribble, say, one small story into it. And I prepare those small novels with small... I do painting as well. So I do a paint over that cover and I'll make my own novels.
Okay.
So my father used to keep those novels in shelves, saying that, okay, this is your first novel, this is your second novel. So that always the same. The germination started since then.
Very young, yeah.
And then my first poetry, I still remember when I was in class 5, that was published in Dainik Bhaskar.
Okay.
So I still have a cutting of that.
Yeah, we always do. We try to keep those.
This is what actually I think every writer comes up from these backgrounds. So on the position where you are today, whom you will give this credit to?
in terms of my authorship journey.
Authorship as well as your entrepreneurship. Both else.
See, entrepreneurship happened, I would say, because of my parents. They are the ones who drove me to, you know, do the MBA. And my father was already running this very successful joint venture with an American company. And I took over the, you know, the India, Middle East and Africa divisions for the pharmaceutical business. And that's how it happened. And of course, I had a fantastic team. So I think my colleagues, people I worked with, really inspired me, you know, particularly the CEO in the US, Mr. Greg Ramsey. I think working with him was a tremendous learning experience for me. My authorship journey, I would say Sohail Mathur, my literary agent, he's the one he's the one who I would give 100% credit, because you know, my first book, I pitched it to him and he took it on with a lot of faith and confidence, got it published with a fantastic publisher and gave me all the guidance and support, because I was completely new to this industry. And he gave me a lot of support. And then my second book, the idea came from him. He's the one who drove me to write The Royal Scandal. You know, and, you know, sort of convinced me and gave me the confidence that I could do something in the area of nonfiction as well. So yes, and then of course the third book. So
you have seen Sohail's interview. Sohail was
here. I saw his interview, yeah.
He's fantastic. I love to chat with him.
Yeah, he has tremendous energy. And he also has a wonderful pulse on the industry, so he knows, you know, what's going on, what works, and that is so important. To know the pulse of the industry is very important.
Very good. To totally buy your words, because I know Sohail and the energy level he has. So
yeah,
when he was on my show, I was saying, actually, like, I am asking a question or you are asking a question to me. So the next question.
Yeah.
How you met Puneet?
How I met Puneet. Puneet and I are both fitness, huge fitness enthusiasts. He's a little more than I am. A little, I would say, a couple of levels above me as far as his passion for fitness is concerned. So we met in a gym.
Okay.
We met in a gym and we had what you call a quintessential love at first sight kind of love story. So yeah, I think within 2 or 3 months of meeting each other, we knew this is it. That's great. How filmy it was.
So, as I said, I stalked you before preparing these questions over Facebook, and I realized that you and Puneet gel very well, going various places and various restaurants. I think you both have a love for food.
We share a love for many things, including food, music, traveling, you know, movies. I know it's wonderful to say that opposites attract, but you do need a lot of common ground if you want to, you know, sort of enjoy life with someone. So in that sense, yes, there's a lot we share.
So you have a son, no?
I have a son.
So because you are into authorship, you are into an entrepreneur business, it's a big business you are maintaining. So what was the first thing which came into your mind when you realized that you have conceived and now you're going to give birth to?
You know, I think, as I've said in my book, in my new book, Sleep Support Insanity, I think it's very important to have a support system. Every mother, every parent needs to have a support system. Where that support system comes from is something that is subjective. So every situation and every person is different. You know, whether that support system comes from your immediate family or from close friends or from a wonderful partner, I think a support system is the answer to this question. So when I actually got to know that I was going to become a mom, I was confident because I was lucky enough to have a solid support system in the form of people who cared about me and who were there to take care of the situation and help me out. You know, I was a novice, completely new. I had no understanding of what a huge commitment this is going to be. So yeah, that's what you need.
It happens. I'll tell you my story. My son is 15 and my daughter is 3 years old. So my wife and we got a news that she has conceived now for my daughter, I'm telling you. And we got a news and after 10 days, it was locked down.
Oh, okay.
And we were like, now what to do? Because it's locked down, COVID was there.
Yeah.
And I don't have parents. My parents passed away some 5-6 years back. So I don't have that support system with me. My wife is having only her mother and she also is not keeping well. So we are worried if we'll tell her then it might be a problem because she will get worried because it's a COVID, it's a lockdown, and now you have conceived, no one can travel, so what will happen?
Yeah.
So we avoid telling her as well.
Okay.
Now the complete 9 months, that it was only she, me and my son, and we managed everything inside that house. So it was like, and unfortunately after first month, doctor said that she need to go in complete bed rest for 3 months.
So it was you and
me and my son and no maids because it was lockdown.
Yeah, of course.
So doing from everything, from mopping, cooking.
But I managing. Suppose, you know, there's also the emotional support of knowing that there is somebody.
Yes.
I mean, kudos to, of course, in your case, you and your wife were together in this. But there are so many single parents out there also who have to single-handedly bring up their children. And it's not easy. I mean, I have friends who are single mom, single dads. It's not easy.
It's not easy.
So parenting is, you know, it takes everything you've got. Mm. You need to put everything into it. There are no shortcuts to parenting. You know that.
Definitely. And the today's world of technology, it's becoming much more tough, I'll
say.
It
is tough.
Yeah.
It is tough.
So for you, like being a mother, being an entrepreneur, being into authorship, how you are juggling between all these things?
I don't know why everybody asks these questions of women. I mean, men don't get asked this question. You know?
Well, I think it goes with men as well.
Yeah, I think anyone, you know, who is a parent knows that there's a lot of multitasking. I always say that, you know, if evolution really works, how come mothers just have two hands?
I'll tell you why, Goddess Durga. Because kids are always closer to their mom. So that's the reason, I think.
Again, I'm not sure about that because I see, and today's father, I think, is truly evolved, coming forward in every sense of the word, a partner in the true sense. You know, my husband is a very hands-on father. My father was a very hands-on father. He's also a very hands-on grandfather. So I think it's a very individual thing. There are many mums who aren't as maybe maternal as we would want them to be. I know personally know families, you know, where maybe the women are the breadwinners. They're going out to work and the men are, you know, taking care of the children as well. So there's an equal caregiving responsibility here. So it's all about cooperation and understanding when two people decide to have a child. I think responsibilities are always divided.
And this is something very important which all the new parents who are going to be, this is something which they should understand, that it's a 50-50. It's not that only one person should take care of everything.
Yeah.
And like I feel like now it's a work from home culture. So
it's
like I never felt like I'm not a mom. So my daughter, she always comes to me when she needs a food.
Yeah.
Or my son is still like, he never goes to his, her mom.
You know, gender, I think gender specific roles are no longer in, you don't get to hear a lot of that anymore. At least it's moving in the right direction.
Yes.
So we have a lot of work still. We need people to understand and to be more empathetic to the situation. Of course, there's also a chapter in the book which talks about the fact that however much anyone may support you, hold you up, you know, and be there for you, we have this new thing of saying we are pregnant and not I am pregnant. Mm. The couple says it. But the physical changes only happen to the woman. So, of course, there is that side of it. But I do feel that things have changed in the last couple of decades.
And they are changing, I think. Yeah. They're regularly changing. So what are the most sleep-deprived things you have ever felt being a mom?
I'm still sleep-deprived. My son is... already 13 and I still feel I don't get a good night's sleep. My husband feels the same way. You never stop being a parent, yeah. I mean, we know that, right? Earlier it was a different reason that used to keep us awake at night. Now I have to keep myself awake to make sure that he's not on his laptop
after I've gone
to, yeah, and you know, he's not doing something he's not supposed to be doing. So there are different reasons. My parents kept awake when I used to be out of the house. So they never slept till I got home, even when I was well into my 20s. So I think parents are always, which is why the first word of the title is sleep and then support and then sanity.
So have you ever resorted to bribery to your child? To cooperate?
Haven't we all? Of course, of course. Bribery and also used penalty as a motivation that if you do this, then this is what the repercussion is going to be.
So what are the biggest bribery you have given till now?
oh God, I have to think about this. It's always football, yeah, these days. My son is a huge football enthusiast. It's always, if you do this, you can't go. If you do this, you can't go. So you can call that bribery, you can call that threats. I never carry out the threats, and now he knows that she just talks. You know, so that's one huge mistake I've made.
So now by now, he understands.
Children are, they understand the pulse very well. They know exactly what their parents are going to do. So, you know, my advice to all mums and dads is, you know, don't let your children see through.
They should understand. Sometimes they will take an action.
Be creatures of mystery. Don't open up all your cards.
Like my daughter, if you say that she's doing something, and she will say, no, you don't do this. So what she will do, she will immediately do this. And make her face like this.
Please. Yeah, children are very manipulative.
She will make such faces that you will start laughing. So generally, idle moms, no, they have a picky line. Like, meri mummy hamesha bolte hai, lappad maar dungi abhi ek. So what's your picky line?
My picky line? So I'm a very emotional mother. You know, and I guess I just tell my son, you know, you know how much I love you, right? So for me, it's always a relationship which is based on love. And I don't just say it, I truly mean it. So when he says something which is, you know, something that I don't want to hear or which I don't appreciate or don't like, I always tell him that, you know, I love you and I trust you. And that works with him. He knows I trust him, and at least until now, he is not broken that trust. So I think that is what works. That's my
how important mantra. It is that generally we have seen it nowadays. I have seen many news articles where parents and kids, they're not gelling well because of these mobile phones, technology. And we know that these things are actually bringing those distances. So what's your view on this? So,
you know, Himanshu, I think technology is a double-edged sword. So when I say that, I basically mean that, you know, there are pros and cons to it.
Yeah.
We can't expect our children. I mean, today if I take his technology away, he'll get left behind. Children are going for coding classes, they're designing their own websites. You know, there's so much that they're doing in terms of technology. Mm. Even school, it's completely driven by technology. Mm. And in the pandemic, more so. They were really taught to, and it is what saved us, right? Technology was our saving grace.
Yes.
So to say that, you know, those parents who say that I want to keep my child completely oblivious to the technological advancements that are happening are deluding themselves. It doesn't work like that. But at the same time, so again, there's a chapter bringing up tech savvy kids in the book, and we've addressed everything, you know. So I think parents need to be as tech savvy as their children. When children get to know that we don't know what they're doing and we don't know how to figure it out, that's when taking advantage happens. So even if you don't know what they're doing, at least pretend to know what they're doing, you know. But yeah, that's how it is.
Because I'm from a telecom background, I'll tell you, it was when 3G was launching. It was not 5G, we are in 5G right now. When 3G was launching, I was in Aircel at that time. And our CEO, when the first 3G network was launched, he was giving a speech over a stage, and he told us that because he used to live in some other country where 3G was already there. So he said, yeah, I realized that India need this internet service, because one day I called my daughter, I shouted that, come down for dinner.
Okay.
And there was no reply. And after some time, my mobile beeped and I looked into it. She messaged me that I'll have dinner in my room. So then that day I realized, okay, the generation and life is changing. Now the communication is coming to your hand in spite of your words. So this is what 3G is, and with the coming days, it will further increase.
Absolutely. We have to learn to live with it graciously. So it's something we just have to coexist with. I'm not a tech-savvy person at all. I'm the kind of person who will stick with my mobile as long as it doesn't completely give up on me. You know, I won't change it. So that's the kind of person I am. But it's not something you can wish away. Technology is here to stay.
We both are same. My wife is behind me to change your mobile, take an Apple. I'm saying, no, I don't want it.
Yeah.
I'm too happy with my Android and I'm not going to change it.
Yeah.
Even, you'll not believe, about 4 years back, I was so much pissed off with these mobiles. that I picked up that 1000 rupees phone of simple button one.
Yeah.
And I used that phone for almost a year.
Yeah.
And what I used to do, I used to just insert my SIM in a smartphone during night for half an hour, just to see if there are any messages or something. And again, I pull it back and I use that
phone. Yeah.
Even in my office, people used to say, what are you doing? You're carrying this 1000. I'm so happy with this. No scrolling, nothing.
Yeah.
I can be what I am.
Yeah.
So I always feel, but still, being in this industry, being an author, you understand that we need to be over this.
Absolutely. And the pandemic taught us. You know, I had to also figure out how to use Zoom, how to use MS Teams. Hmm. Those weren't platforms I'd used before.
Plus,
COVID.
I'm on YouTube is like now going for me bigger than being an author.
Yeah.
Like my last book came 3 years back.
Okay.
Now the next one is coming in August.
Yeah.
But in these 3 years, I was actually on YouTube. So for me, like scrolling YouTube, looking into what the content is, what is trending. So there is so much to research for me that every podcast what I shoot, actually I try to figure out that what is going to run on my show, what my viewers will watch. So that's why I actually message you. I know that this book is something which so many young people are going to buy it. And young people would love to know about these topics.
True.
So I have to keep on scroll and look into it. Ki what's the content? What is getting selling? What is selling on YouTube? So that is very important for me. So coming back to your book and the topic. So being a mom, if I say that you have to spend a night out with your son. So what's your imagination of a night out?
My son?
Yeah.
Well, I think considering how much passion he has for football right now, I would love to take him to a football game.
Night out?
Yeah, I mean, they happen, right? So, okay, let's look at an entire day out or a weekend out. So, okay. We do a football game, maybe we go for a movie. Yeah, and he enjoys watching movies with me, at least until recently. And my son enjoys different types of cuisine. So, he loves food. He's very fitness conscious, but at the same time, he enjoys experimenting with food. So taking him out for a meal is a huge pleasure, because from sushi to, you know, every type of European food. When we were in Finland, I remember he was actually so much more adventurous. He had this thing called a reindeer burger. And I asked him, he was younger then, I said, you know, you remember Rudolph, right? He said, yeah, but that's a different reindeer. So that's the kind of passion he has for food. So taking him out for a meal is always a pleasure for my husband and for me. We love going out with him. So yeah.
But okay, coming to a different topic, you said you are too much into fitness.
Yeah.
But I have seen that you are too much into restaurants.
Into restaurants? No, but we eat healthy. We make very healthy choices.
That's what my question is actually.
Yeah.
So what you eat actually? Because frankly telling you, me and my wife, we too are too much into diet conscious. So like, we don't eat wheat, we are into completely millet diets, we use very, very less oil, we try to cook in a oil-free things
format,
and everything.
Yeah.
So whenever we think that, okay, once in a month we should go out, we always feel that if we go anywhere, it will be like oil to ho gayi hoga, or some wheat to hoga, ye to hoga.
See, wheat is something which I personally can't live without. I'm a Punjabi. And in the north, it's what we've grown up on. And I do believe...
Naan ke kaam nahi hona.
Naan, I don't know. Yeah, I love it. See, my point is that, you know, something you've grown up on is not going to do you any harm. I know there are a lot of new fads that have come out. But we eat everything. I haven't given up anything. So it's not like I don't have lactose or I don't have wheat. Yes, we do avoid... I've given up eating very oily food. My husband and I both. In fact, at home, all of us, you know. I think when we go out, we just make very healthy choices. You know, I love to get a fresh salad. I really enjoy that. A lot of times my friends will be like, oh, you know, you're depriving yourself. But for me, food is no more junk. For me, food is about, so I enjoy, truly enjoy a fresh salad or a plate of, you know, sushi or a good soup in the winter. And at home, we're very careful. Yeah. So if you're very careful 6 days of the week, then one day you can indulge. And we work out.
Definitely.
We work out. I work out almost every day. And I do intense cardio. My husband, of course, is into all kinds of things. You know, he's into swimming. He goes to the gym. So we're very physically very, we push ourselves.
I think that is very, very, very important now.
It is.
And I think this every young person should actually learn this. I was not so fitness freak, but yes, from last 4-5 years, I'll say that I'm regular. At least if I'm not going to gym, but I'll walk 2 times a day.
Yeah.
I'll definitely walk it. Diet, obviously, I remember about 4 years back, I was 85-86 kgs.
And you
lost a lot. Now, today I'm 72.
Yeah.
I've lost that weight and I'm stable on that.
And at home also now, we've learned how to cook all our favorite things in a healthier way. So, the pandemic, so many things we learned. Home cooking. We discovered all the joys of home cooking. So, there's a lot we make at home also.
So, what you cook for your son?
For my
son. Something what he loves.
So, breakfast has to be done by me.
Okay.
So we have a cook, but he wants his eggs to be done. I do very good eggs. So whether it is a good fried egg or a scrambled egg or eggs, whatever, an omelette or whatever, he likes that. Then I make very good pancakes.
Mm-hmm.
I make a really good lamb stew, good pastas. Yeah, so he likes my cooking. I'm a good cook.
And you get time to cook for him?
Time is always a problem. In the pandemic, we did a lot of cooking.
Mm.
And now with the weather being as hot as it is, I try to avoid entering the kitchen. But in the winter we do.
Being an entrepreneur, you have so much work to do.
Yeah,
you go traveling.
Cooking is therapeutic. Yeah. It's like, I look at it as me time, so it's fun.
Okay.
It's fun.
And what's the biggest lie you have said to your son so that he can eat vegetables?
I keep telling him that his favorite football stars eat all these things. The moment I say Ronaldo or Messi is eating it. Now, of course, he's becoming smarter. When he was maybe 11 or 12, I could lie a little more convincingly. Now he knows exactly. He knows my pulse points now. So this stage is not one that I'm particularly happy about. But yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, if you tell him his favorite football stars are doing something, you can make him do it.
When he was small, 1 year or somewhere, have you ever used baby wipes for a regular wipe? As a regular wipe?
Baby wipes as a regular wipe for myself? Yeah, of course. We carry those little, in our bags. And of course, they're multi-purpose.
So I said, I'm just asking normal questions so that people can understand what a mom goes through all these challenges.
Yeah.
So, and one thing what I have also seen, like when your kids are small and you are in a washroom, they will definitely come and bang.
He still does that, particularly on weekend mornings, because he wakes up a little before me.
Okay.
So by the time I wake up, he's ready for breakfast. So he comes and he knocks on the bathroom door and he's like, make breakfast. So, yeah.
My son, he's 15 now, but today I'm coming for a shoot. He knows. So I can show you a message. Last night at 1 a.m. he has messaged me that tomorrow morning you are going for a shoot. You will not be available for whole day. Please cook white sauce pasta for me. Because he loves white sauce pasta. That is the only shoot. Should be cooked by me only.
Okay.
Because my wife said, I cannot cook it. It's just a lot of time. So he always asks me to cook it. He messaged me that you need to cook it before you leave for your podcast. Because then you will come in the evening and I want that.
Okay.
So that's the way that he...
Yeah. Which is what I said, This is how it is. All those gender... that gender differentiation is now disappearing.
It's disappearing. Disappeared for me.
And there is a chapter in the book also which is titled Birthing a Father. So in that, I've actually given evidence. There is scientific evidence which shows that a father's brain looks very similar to a mother's brain when a child is born in terms of cognitive and emotional engagement. And also hormonal. People think that only the mom goes through the hormonal changes. That's not true.
Mm-hmm.
There is a significant drop in the testosterone hormone and a rise in oxytocin, which is your love hormone, in a father's body.
Mm-hmm.
So that basically just tells us, that a role that comes as naturally to men as it does to women
mm-hmm.
has been limited because of gender differentiation over the centuries. And it's really sad that men have been deprived, because I know that men also want to be with their children.
Mm.
They love their children as much. Who's anyone to say that the kids bond more with the mom? I think it's both parents.
Very true.
That's how nature made it, right? Nature made it two parents.
Actually, this question of gender, no, I actually picked up this question after reading that chapter only.
Yeah.
So all the questions, when I framed these questions, I was in a mood like I should not be asking direct questions from your book. It should be like something related to your book. So I felt that those questions will be more unbiased questions and will be more funny questions, which should be engaging.
Yeah, absolutely.
So that's the reason I picked up few questions like that. So coming back on the tantrum part, so I remember my tantrum from my daughter is shows tantrum, but she's like, you just divert her. Okay, no, we'll give you that. She will forget that.
Yeah.
But my son, like we remember, if he says, no, I want this, then he want that.
Yeah.
He will show tantrum, but if I say, no, I'm not going to buy you, he will show me for some time. He will gussa ho jayega kafi der ke. But then he gets normal. So what's the biggest tantrum your son would have shown you? You are in a mall or some place.
It's been going on, Himanshu. There isn't one, you know. So right from actually lying down on the floor in a public place, you know, where we have to drag him, to meltdowns in the park, you know, I think tantrums become a part of a parent's life from the word go. And my son, that way, completely he understood that he was the center, you know, of everyone's universe at that time. So, which is why I think it's very important for parents not to do that. Mm. And in India, we tend to do that a lot. We tend to make our children the center of everything, which is not something you can carry on forever, right? When they grow up, they step out into the world. And that is when they realize the hard reality that they're not the center.
Mm.
You know, so I think it's good to have a balanced approach. As much as you may love them and as much as you may want to give them everything in your capacity, I think it's really important to teach children from a very early age that you know, it's not always possible to get to have things the way you want them. So that is something we need to learn, I think, in India for sure. We need to learn that.
Definitely. That's
and I'm a part of that. I'm also an Indian mother. So I know that I've also done that. If I could go back, that is one thing I would do a little differently. You know, at least not palpably show him how much I want to do things the way he wants them to be done. Just prepare them a little better for the world.
That's true. That's very important, actually. Yeah. There is one more change what we have seen nowadays, a nuclear family to a now individual family is what we are. Because when we are joint family and nuclear family.
Yeah.
So I remember that I lived in a joint family when I was a kid. So
yeah.
We have, say, 13, 14. Kids of same age living together, so parents were least bothered. They know that grandparents are there, chacha chachi is there, or they would be playing with their cousins, and life was very simple for the parents at that time. So do you feel that it's becoming more challenging being in a nuclear family?
I don't think so. Again, you know, there are pros and cons to both. I think it's becoming the way now. There are more and more families where, in fact, why just nuclear families? When you think about it, I have a friend, a very close friend, who lives in the same condominium as me. She and her kids live in Gurgaon and her husband had to move. So it's not a family that's been separated. There's no separation there, but for practical reasons, because his job took him somewhere else, he had to move out. And, you know, again, parents sometimes have to take those hard decisions. So today she's with her kids in Gurgaon and the husband is in Bangalore. Now, it's a smaller family unit, you know, and her family isn't here, like her extended family doesn't live in Delhi. So at the end of the day, you know, all these permutations and combinations, which is why we talk about a dynamic support system. A support system is subjective to every situation, it's different. So while a lot of nuclear families, I think, do a brilliant job, you know, and two parents, I mean, the parents together. I think sometimes in those cases, the children are very, very close to their parents. Some joint families work out very, very well, you know, if there is an understanding between the members. So I think the key word is understanding. And as long as you agree on the basic value systems that you want to inculcate in your children, there has to be agreement there. I think it's something that it's a win-win situation for everyone. So if it's a joint family, I think it's wonderful. The children are going to get so much more love from so many more people. But if you don't have that, then you make do with what you do. And you know, the parents bring the children up. But I feel it's very important to have an understanding of the core values that you want to inculcate in your kids.
Very true.
There should be agreement there.
So have you ever Googled about being a good mom or to handle some?
Yeah. And in the book I've written, please don't Google. You know? Because I know we all Google, right? Even when I was expecting, I think every trimester is different. So Google is our best friend, and it shouldn't be, because a lot of the information out there is not really information you can rely on. So Googling is okay. What I've said in the book is surfing should always be carried out with caution, whether you're doing it on a keyboard or in the middle of the ocean, you know, on a surfboard.
I'll tell you, when my son was about to born, so there was a book of Johnson and Johnson, which tells you a weekly progress of a baby in a womb.
Yeah.
So now it is like a peanut size or this size, what is happening, you know, heartbeat comes. So every week, that book is completely into week-wise. So every chapter is 1 week and it will tell you everything, that what should you eat, what should you not eat, what's the womb is happening, what is happening in the womb. So everything it goes like that. So we bought that book and me and my wife both were reading that. So while I was reading that book, after some time I realized that this could be a very good story.
Right.
So my second novel actually, I'm Always Here With You. That book actually is the same. So it's a story of a couple. They met in the school, then they did college together, and then they got married. So now they're starting only, she has conceived, now they're planning a baby.
Okay.
So with every week or every month progress, what is shown in the book, he reads that and he tries to relate with his past. That how that growth is, the relationship growth has happened because of that. So with every month, he decides that okay, after every month I'll write one letter, that how you're growing in a womb and how me and your mother has grown in the relationship in the past.
Yeah.
So he started writing those letters for his baby.
Okay.
And although it's a sad book, so after sixth letter he dies.
Oh.
So it's a story about that. So so I remember that idea actually came to me by reading that complete trimester wise. So what's your suggestion to young mom who have conceived recently?
So when we were talking about information, I think for a young mother, or you know, for anyone who is going through a different stage of parenting, even when you are bringing up a teenager, everything changes. Information, reliable information, is very important. I think Google is fine, you know, but if you have people you can rely on to provide. So for me, when it comes to health issues, I have always relied on my child's pediatrician. He in fact has also endorsed the book. He's been like a, you know, a support part, a huge part of my support system. And again, faith, you know, is so important, because if you're relying on someone for information, you need to have faith in that person.
Definitely.
So we were lucky, we are lucky, we have a fantastic pediatrician. He is somebody we can call upon. And so information is something which one should have access to. Today, as the mother of a teenager, I really need information from, whether it is from other mothers who've already been through that phase, or whether it is from reliable published sources. But I need to know that I'm not alone in this journey. There is this little quote, you can say it to me, I'm a mother too. It is so important, you know, to know that there are other people who are in the same situation as you are. That itself gives you confidence and solace.
True, very true. So in the next section now, I'll give you one word which will be related to this chapter only.
Yeah.
But I would like you, for that word, give a message to the young parents.
All right. Okay? I'll try.
Diapers. A message should be like something, that they should know about that.
Consider yourself lucky. Remember that there were generations that had to do without diapers. So.
No, but what's the message to them? Like, if they are going to conceive and they are planning it, regarding diapers, what they should keep in mind?
Stock up. they go out of stock very fast. Stock up on diapers.
And one thing which I was actually too much confused about it, pants or the traditional one?
No, the pants.
Pants.
Yeah, the slip-ons.
I was like too much confused. What should be used?
But the pants.
Pants. Yeah, pants are best.
Yeah.
Okay.
I can't believe I still remember. It's been It's been a while. Yeah, okay.
With I remember with my son at that time pants.
Yeah, they
just
hadn't come out. Yeah,
they
yeah.
were not there. I think they started up, but those qualities were not good at that time. They were not so comfortable. So it was
Pampers.
A traditional
Pampers. Pampers is Pampers. The brand. Yeah.
But for my daughter, we have used the pants. Okay, chocolates.
Indulge your kids. Absolutely. They have antioxidants. They put children in a good mood. So.
But those are dark chocolates.
No. All chocolates.
But sugar content? Because doctors say no, that
limit
the sugar will create a problem in your development of brain growth.
It's, you know, the jury is out on that. In a limit. Everything in a limit.
Okay. Tantrums.
Tantrums. Don't indulge tantrums. So don't stay very, very firm. Stay firm.
Fever.
Don't panic. Because children, you know, they tend to, the fever tends to really go high. In, you know, with children, it's always 103, 100. And mothers, I think, really panic. Here, mothers panic. So do fathers. My husband used to panic more than me. I would still go and, you know, sort of take a break. And he would be sitting there and bathing our son's head with those cold towels. So, yeah, but don't panic.
Giving a wash to a 10 days old baby.
Giving a wash. Turn on the music and do it. I always bathed my son with the music on, nursery rhymes. Make a happy atmosphere. It's more fun.
Soap.
Soap. Johnson & Johnson.
Okay. Nowadays we have Sebamed, Cetaphil.
Yeah,
Johnson & Johnson ki khushbu badi achi.
And it's like an age old thing, you know. It's what we've all grown up with.
So. Hair wash.
I think. So I remember that I used to wash my son's hair every day, shampoo it every day, so every day, hair wash every day, J&J.
Sun we have done every day.
Or mother care is also very good.
Sebamed is also good. Like my son we have done every day, but my daughter we cannot do, she's having long hairs, it's not easy to do it every day, so it's like twice a week, it's done. Potty.
Parents get used to it. There's again a little bit in the book about how, you know, perfectly normal people think it's okay to talk about this in a public situation or in a social setting, because it's, when we become parents, we just become so oblivious to everything other than our child. So all these things, there's a normalizing of it which happens.
True. And the last one, I think I'm forgetting it. Morning breakfast. Think about 1 year, 2 year old.
Yeah. It was always it was Cerelac, and then it was scrambled eggs.
Porridge.
So porridge, oats, Quaker oats. You know, there was, I don't know if they still have the strawberry and the kesar flavored ones. The kesar ones taste like kheer. And my son used to love them. In fact, I remember when we traveled to Dubai for a family holiday, we carried those packets. And then the hotel said that we can't allow outside food, and I panicked. Because I said, now what will he eat for breakfast? So yeah, Quaker oats.
Like my daughter, she has a fixed taste of porridge. She will eat porridge with anjeer, almond and walnuts.
That's a healthy breakfast.
So, we travel somewhere, we need to carry those things.
Yeah.
Uske bina uska breakfast.
Nahin, of course, you have to carry. Which brings us to traveling with children. I mean, again, there's a chapter in the book. Complete chapter on traveling.
We used to travel. There should be one point what I was forgetting. It was travel.
Yeah.
What you should remember when you're traveling.
There's a full chapter. So, you know, people should read the book to know, because traveling with children is a completely different ball game. Yeah.
I remember whenever I go somewhere, like last year I went to Mukteshwar. There's a resort called Slowness Himalayas. So it's a sort of homestay between the farmlands. So I called them. I said, okay, I'm coming with my daughter. She's just 2 years old. I need these things. Do you have suji? You do have this? They said, okay, sir, everything will be available. You just
child
come.
Friendly.
Child
Look
friendly.
Look for child friendly.
There's so
the
many things
word.
need to be checked. Yeah. When you go to a 5-star hotel, you will think, okay, you are not able to get what she eats.
Okay. No, I think so. The chapter here covers everything about traveling. It's
definitely
a totally different ballgame.
So, my last question. What's the most unrealistic expectation you had about parenthood before having your kid?
That he would sleep. You know, I think sleep is something which is so basic. I had this. So I remember, you know, we used to go to Mothercare shop, and before he was born, I bought this gorgeous crib. And I remember Puneet told me, you know, why don't we wait and see his sleep pattern? I think maybe men are a little more practical in this regard. I said, no, I had this image in my mind. I would change his clothes at night, this beautiful night suit, and this, you know, very calm and sleepy baby, and place him into the crib, and he will sleep through the night and wake up just in time for feeds. My son never slept in that crib. So I think that was the biggest misconception that I had about motherhood.
For my son, I remember he was having that crib and he used to jump in that.
Yeah, they do
he
that.
He jumped so much that it broke from...
It's like a playpen for them, you know. It's not a place to sleep, it's just a place to play.
Yes. So it's fantastic to have you on this show. So guys, this is the book. If you are planning a baby or if you have recently had a baby, go with this, Sleep, Support and Sanity. It's a beautiful book, available over Amazon and all the major bookstores and everywhere. It's a complete guide for you. That we have just talked about some funny things and some little bit about it, but there are a lot more things which you need to understand when you are parenting a baby. So it's very, very, very important.
Yeah, it's basically, it takes you through the entire process of from the time the child is born to the time he or she becomes a teenager.
So it covers the first 13, 14 years. Audience that why they should read this book.
Why they should read the book? Okay, let me hold it. I'm always happy to hold my book. I think it is a book that every parent, mom or dad, even every grandparent would relate really well with. It covers... So from, you know, the challenge to get enough sleep, to birthing a father, to, you know, how to handle unsolicited advice, how to handle your other relationships, how to travel with children, how to maintain work-life balance, how to bust the supermom myth, you know, how to organize that perfect playdate, how to be the PPDM, as I've called her, the perfect playdate mom. To throwing a birthday party that your child will remember for a long, long time, to mental health and motherhood, reclaiming your old self, you know, how to be, how to not give in to the rat race that children are being subjected to, choosing the right school, the right preschool, inculcating the habit of reading in your child, having fun with fitness, how to bring up tech-savvy kids. It covers everything.
Everything.
Yeah.
So, nice talking to you, Rashmiya. Thanks for being on this show.
Thank you,
and giving all the insights.
Yeah, I mean, I just want to say, you know, that I'm really grateful to my agent and to my publisher. So the book is represented by The Book Bakers and published by Om Books. It's available everywhere. Give it a read. I'm sure you will love it.
Thank you. Thanks for being on this show.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.